Once upon a time, somewhere, no one knows exactly where, deep in the Malifaux bio, there stands a shack. There are many ordinary tumble-down shacks scattered throughout the treacherous twists and turns of the bio, but there is nothing ordinary about this one. This one, which is never to be found in the same place twice, is the home of Zoraida the Hag, feared by those unlucky or foolish enough to tread through the bio trails. For years, whenever Zoraida has left her hut on some baleful errand, the bio has pricked up its green and fetid ears to the muffled sounds of the smallest of wars coming from inside the wooden walls. Small, yes, but vicious and without equal. A war of cloth and stuffing, of stitches and magic, of buttons and patches, of needles and thread. If you listen very, very carefully, you can hear the puppets fighting. Hi, welcome back to the Box of Delights. We're playing Puppet Wars Unstitched. This is a miniature baseball game for two or more players from Weird Miniatures. In the box you'll find 44 plastic miniatures. We've got two Puppet Wars fake decks, so you've got enough to play two players. We've got some plastic tokens and some cardboard exhausted tokens. We've got puppet stat cards. A rule book, some instructions on how to put the miniatures together, because yes, you're going to have to glue these guys, and a highly coloured thick stock game board. The minis are really highly detailed. You've got three masters, five sidekicks, and they're all unique figures, and then you've got 12 pawns of three of each. The game box has a foam insert so you can protect your figures when you pack it away. And yeah, they do stand in here just fine, the game board on top. In this video, I'm going to give you an instruction on how to play and a demonstration of gameplay so you can get a good feel for how this game plays. There's not a great deal out there on this game and it deserves a little bit more exposure, so we're going to give it the Box of Delights treatment. I'm going to set up a two-player game for you, and each player will choose a master. We've got Seamus and Lady Justice for this demo. The third available to you is Pokey Victoria. Each player takes their master card, and then eight puppets. And there's two types of puppets that you can have in your puppet army. There's pawns and sidekicks, and the rules tell us that no more than a quarter of your puppets can be sidekicks. So for the regular shoebox game, that's a maximum of two sidekicks, and I've got six pawns then alongside them. At the start of the game, all your puppets except your masters will be in the toy box, and your masters will start on the game board. The first thing we do is select a map. Now all the colours, the decoration you see here, that's purely cosmetics. What's important is that we've got this hex map, and in the back of the rule book there's different maps that you can then set up with these impassable terrains and what these things here with the saw and hammer, which are called workbenches. So I'm going to set up, I guess, with map one to give you an introduction to the game. So all we need to do is take these plastic impassable terrain tokens and set them up on the board in this configuration. And in addition, these three here are neutral workbenches. So all we do is choose a colour for our neutral workbenches, place them in the same configuration, and then each player will take a colour. So we'll have green for Seamus and this purple colour for Lady Justice. And these two red ones represent their starting workbenches. Workbenches are places where you're going to spawn your puppets. And the idea of the game is to either defeat the opponent's master or capture their workbenches. And these neutral ones, these are workbenches that during the course of the game you can capture and make your own. And if you ever end up with no workbenches, you lose the game. Okay, that's the board all set up. You can see we've got three neutral workbenches in yellow. Lady Justice is going to begin here Seamus here, and these are impassable terrain. The board has a very high gloss on it, so you're going to see some shimmers here, so some extra challenges for me filming, but it looks absolutely wonderful when it's set up on the table.
As far as choosing your army of puppets is concerned, two sidekicks, and then you can have up to three of each pawn. Okay, so here we've got the Silurid pawn. We've got Bete Noire and the Hooded Rider here as Seamus's sidekicks. You'll notice I've not painted these. I mean, the ideal you would have these painted and it would look a fabulous miniatures game. So it's kind of like a miniatures board game. For Lady Justice, I've chosen the Judge and Zaki, which is one of my favourite looking minis. These little plastic minis are really highly detailed.
A turn in Puppet Wars consists of five animation rounds, and an animation is when you activate one of your puppets. And during an animation, you can either bring one of your puppets from your toy box, your reserves from your toy box, to one of your workbenches, or you can activate one of or animate one of the puppets that's already on the board. And an animation consists of moving and taking an action. Alright, and there's five animation rounds per turn. And remember your objectives. We're going to put Seamus on any tile next to his starting workbench. And Lady Justice the same. And our job as a player is to defend our master and to try and capture all the opponent's workbenches. So these neutral ones, we can capture these. Obviously that makes our opponent's job a little bit harder. So we're going to be using our actions to move around the board and attack one another. Alright, so it's a two-player confrontation.
Let's take a closer look at one of these puppets. So this is Executioner. Here's his name and his characteristics. So these are metal pawn. These are his stitches. He's got three stitches. That's kind of like his health, right? When all his stitches are torn apart, then the puppet's torn apart. He's kind of killed, if you like, right? This is his movement, so he can move one hex per animation. This figure here is his defense value, four, with the thimble icon. Three, the scissors, this is his combat value. And number one here is the upgrade limit. So there's different attachments. Now these puppets are double-sided. When they're torn apart, they kind of leave little pieces of themselves. So when the executioner is torn apart, all its stitches are gone, he leaves some glowy claws. And then other puppets can pick up these claws and use their abilities. So this one increases the number of rips inflicted by this puppet's attacks by one. Okay, power plus one. This number up here in the top right is the animation requirement. And in the case of Executioner, it's five RAM. There's five suits in Puppet Wars. And these kind of come from the Malifaux world. We've got crows, rams, masks, and tomes. So the animation requirement here is one crow, here five RAM, three mask, and five tome. We've also got these ones which are suitless. Okay, they've kind of got these gears here. We need a two to animate this, but no suit. Okay, well, what does that mean? Well, each player is going to get a fate deck and puppet deck. And in this puppet deck, it's like a 54 card deck, actually, because there's a couple of jokers in here. There's all these different cards. And each card has a pip value and a suit. So this is the Ace of Rams, two of Tomes, 11 Rams, 13 mask, 12 crow, okay, 13 ram, 5 tome, 4 crow, 10 mask, and then we've got a couple of jokers in here as well. So there's the red joker, which has a pip value of 14, and it can take on any suit. This is kind of like a, well, it's a joker, like a wild card. And then we've got the black joker, which has no suit and a zero pip value. So this is your puppet deck. And each player gets a puppet deck, and they're going to draw a hand. And the number of cards they get is 4 plus the number of workbenches they control, which at the beginning of the game is 1. So they can start the game with 5 cards. So you're going to be playing cards out of your hand, and in order to animate puppets from your toy box, you're going to need the animation requirement. So for example, Seamus here, if he wants to animate the Silurid, needs 6 masks. Well, what we've got here, we've got an 8 mask. So that's enough, right? The pip value has to be higher and it has to contain the suit. So we can use an 8 mask card. We've got 11 crow here. So although the animation value is 6 and this is an 11, it's got a suit of crow, not of mask. So the suit's wrong. Okay, we need to match the pip value or higher and the suit. So let's get ready for the start of the game. Seamus' team, Lady Justice, a starting hand of 5 cards each. Okay, for the sake of the video, I'm going to put these, I've got red and green counters because I've not got the figures painted, just so you can see who is on whose side. So that when we start animating some of our puppets, green for Seamus, red for Lady Justice. You'll also notice on the hexes there's a dot in the centre of each hex. This is for line of sight rules. So if a puppet's attacking an adjacent puppet, you draw a line between the two dots, or maybe one hex away, you draw a line between the two dots. And you need line of sight. So for Seamus here, to get line of sight here, you draw a line between these two dots, and obviously there's an impassable terrain. This mountain tile means Seamus doesn't have line of sight here. It does have line of sight here. And incidentally, it does have line of sight here. So if line of sight travels along the side of a hex, then line of sight is granted. If the line passes through any parts, if you look at this hex here, if you draw a line from this dot to here, then Seamus wouldn't have line of sight because he's cutting through this tile here with this impassable terrain. Alright, so Seamus would have line of sight here, 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 here. Alright, so it's pretty simple. Line of sight rules, nice and simple, dot to dot.